They didn't want to penalize them, so they prefer to penalize the demand. Now with fines, with data on fines, I'm going to show you in a couple of slides, more or less we can know the size of the demand, but still is the size of the demand that was fined in Germany. Yes.
I'm sorry, can I make a question, quick question?
Sure.
I really miss a precise definition of prostitution, which you haven't said yet, and that is very important and crucial for the discussion, and also a precise definition for sex crime.
So the definition for prostitution and sex crime is available in the paper, but is the one that the BRA, which is maybe pronounced bro, I don't know Swede, but is basically the statistic department for crime in Sweden gives, because it's the only one for which I have data about. And so prostitution is connected to selling sex in exchange of money, while the definition of sex crimes change year to year, and this would motivate the inclusion of year six effect, because every year they try to have a more flexible definition to take as different sort of crime connected to sex crimes as they can. But in the paper, I give a definition, and especially the one that is related to BRA, the one that is written by this institution, is the one I can use because it's the one for which I have data.
Okay, so I see that there are a lot of gray areas around the definition of prostitution that you might think of and make that a deeper question. It is not clear at all exactly what prostitution is, and you can think of many examples that are in between what you think is legal and what you think is illegal. Or immoral. I don't know. I'm confused about that.
Yeah, this is something that usually takes place with prostitution. So even the term prostitution, even the term prostitute might be debated because people now call it sex work. So here I call it prostitution because in the data it's called prostitution. If the data was called sex work, I would have called sex work. And different authors in the scholarship have different definitions. So I think it's debatable and it's difficult to agree. We might agree to disagree. But at least from my point of view, I don't want to give a definition that is mine because I don't think it would add anything. While I want to analyze the data and see what the data can teach us or tell us or how can help us, let's say.
Well, yes, just to say that I think there are some information about people that buy sex. Usually it is through survey to people in general. And in those surveys, usually the question is, did you buy sex in the last 6 months? Things like this. And there is a political correctness bias in these kind of answers. So usually people say more or less 20% of men say they do it. Imagine this is the minimum, in fact, it's higher. It could be, imagine 30%, something like this, of the population in Spain, according to surveys.
We'll take a source of that.
I am thinking about one colleague of you in your university. She's an anthropologist,
Carmen Meneses.
Carmen Meneses. I remember one survey did by Carmen Meneses. And I think the percentage was around 20%, but this is the minimum.
The main issue is that so in and there is a in this scholarship is not connected to sociology. There is also a really famous scholar which is called Melissa Farley, and basically she studied this issue in the UK and in the States. The main issue with all this scholarship is that it's not representative. The data they have is not representative of the whole country or of usually a given city. So I like a lot to read these papers for understanding which mechanism can be behind, but it's difficult for me to extrapolate I can use them to extrapolate the size of something, but it'd be difficult to know whether this would be representative of anything at a national level, at least. While if we ask questions connected to how these people think, then for sure I think they are representative because they ask questions that are specific and that they answer. So the research question I like to answer is whether the prostitution affects sex crimes. And if this is the case, what mechanisms could explain this effect? So this is quite demanding somehow because the data on prostitution and sex crime is scarce. In fact, economics, economic literature per se, forgot about the existence of prostitution for many years. Even if, just to give you an example, even if Gary Baker spoke about crime economics in the 60s, we had to wait until 2002 to get a paper published in one of the top five journals, which was in this case the Journal of Political Economy, about prostitution. So we had to wait 40 years. And so I think at least the solution is to speak about these issues and to try to get the data and so motivate why this is important.
One question on your mind, let's see. Your research question is there evidence on whether criminalization decreased one of the two sides of the market or both?
So, now I'm going to speak in a couple of slides about literature review. We have evidence about decriminalization and evidence about criminalization connected to the supply or the demand, but for different outcomes from the one I studied. And all this evidence sprang, all this evidence arose in the same years in which I was studying.
It's crucial to understand the mechanisms as to why criminalizing prostitution may affect the willingness to commit a crime. Particularly if something occurs in if there's some sort in or out of the market.
Yeah, so this is exactly what they find. Okay. And that is the contribution and previous results. So, the main contribution is that, from my understanding, this is the first paper study the effect of criminalizing the purchase of prostitution on rape. And this paper finds that fines for sex purchase boost sex crimes. And these results are are robust to multiple specifications. I would see a fudge difference in difference between study and the instrumental variable. So the result is similar across the three techniques. The effects appear to be larger for criminalizing than for decriminalizing, which is the main evidence we have in the literature. Mechanisms, I explore supply and demand. And I find that results are demand-driven, and it's happening something of the sort of what Marcello would say, that there are some customers that are moving out or that preferences are changing because they commit different types of rape after this legislation is introduced. And we'll end the debate actually with this. Analysis. So, related literature. I'll be brief about it, but I think it's important to know where we are. So, there have been
I do complain a bit about your lack of discussion on causality.
I will be there in a couple of
minutes. Yeah, in introduction. Given that you are so straight with your title, I think this paper is basically about causality.
I will discuss.
So either I take seriously your causality approach, or I don't like your title. Because your title is an assessment and implies causality.
Yes.
So if you want to go ahead with that title, you should start talking about causality.
Okay.
This is my
feeling. In the introduction, I speak a lot about the identification assumption earlier. Here, I'll speak about the identification assumption. After explaining a couple of things, but I have some slides only devoted to that with data.
Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, totally. I have to speak
Scott, why the find approve your title.
Yeah, yeah, I totally understand it. This is why the issue is that this paper is like 90 pages. So I'm trying to summarize it as best as I can, but it's complicated. And I totally understand the complaint. I hope by the end of the seminar, you'll tell me that.
I buy your time.
Yeah. In any case, identification, causality always relies on identification assumption. Identification assumption can be subjective sometimes, unless I have a randomized control trial. So I'll do my best to address
this is the problem,
it.
You don't have a natural experiment.
Yeah, this is sort of a natural experiment, but then still in another experiment, you have to buy that the treatment was exogenously, was like quasi randomly allocated. But I will get to that in a couple of slides. Okay. So,
on this point, I think, can you think, so top of your head, what is the quasi-natural experiment in your paper? So you were very detailed in the results.
Yes.
Tell us in a sentence.
There are, since I used three techniques, I rely on two different identification assumptions. For the ID, I rely on the identification assumption exploiting a variation in intercontinental flights, which proxy sex tourism. So if intercontinental flights only affect prostitution through rape, in the sense that people that affect rape through prostitution, in the sense that sex tourism is going, and I'm going to explain it after this slide, is going to another country to buy prostitution. So people who used to buy prostitution in Sweden and then were penalized, face the option to organize this voyage in the streets to buy prostitution elsewhere. First of all, the fact that flight company do not choose when to offer these flights because of sex tourism, which to the best of my knowledge makes sense, and if this variation only affects rape through prostitution, which also, from my understanding, makes sense, then maybe can have a causal interpretation. Okay, so exclusion restriction and exogenous instrument. While the fuzzy definition and the event study analysis rely on the timing of fines being issued. So I have data about the amount of fines that are issued each month. Okay. But for this interpretation, I only use the time. So I have a binary variable taking value 1 if a fine was issued. So why I do that? Because I consider that the quantity of fines that were issued can be connected to demand patterns. But the time in which it took place is not connected to whether 300 fines were issued or 2 were issued. And if that makes sense, then I can say I have a regular common trend assumption in the sense that regions that didn't experience a fine event would have evolved as regions that experienced a fine event would have evolved as regions that didn't experience a fine event. But it's a fuzzy difference because all units are treated by the end of a sample period. I don't have any pure control group. Okay, so this is why I have to rely on a different technique.
Is your strategy of interpretation study novel, or have you already completed?
No, I bought it from Chess Martin and Dr. Fowler.
Use it for the same purpose? Or is it...
No, they use it, they only develop the technique and then apply it in a paper of Esther Duflo or. The effect of education on wages, on the effect of opening schools, not connected to prostitution. But I was looking for a technique that could be used. So, first of all, a recent trend of the literature provided causal evidence that commercial sex or decriminalization of prostitution reduces rape. I contributed to this literature. Here, basically, there are three papers. First one studied this issue in the Netherlands, so with red light district. Other one studied these issues in the States, where Rhode Island depenalized prostitution by mistake. I judged the granite prostitution for some years by mistake. So we use a synthetic this and this. And then my paper with Professor Diaschi uses variation in the opening at day level of adult entertainment establishments, being these strip clubs and the escort door services, to study how they affect sex crimes in New York City. But now there is a growing line of the literature studying how different regulation of prostitution affects different outcomes connected to prostitution. So here I will mention only three papers. There are three, four more. This one is a theoretical paper that relies on Edward and Cort 2002, which is this paper that I just told you was published in the Journal of Political Economy about prostitution. It's another theoretical paper, and try to study how prostitution laws can affect human trafficking. Their main finding is that the Nordic model can eradicate trafficking, but first you need to eradicate voluntary prostitution. And they suggest another model, another law, in which you criminalize customers if they don't buy prostitutes. So you introduce licensed prostitution, like in the Netherlands, but for customers who do not buy prostitution from licensed prostitution, you penalize them and issue fines for this type of customers. And then we have two empirical papers, okay? This one is by Berlin, Giancarlo Spagnolo, Murdino. They use a distinctive approach using differences in the share of female politicians and the police and officers, stating that this might represent how strict they enforce the law, to study the effect of the ban on violence against women. Their findings suggest that domestic violence was boosted because of the ban. And then there is this paper by Cameron Mood and Shah, Manisha Shah from UCLA, the same Mood here. And they use this natural experiment in Indonesia where the sale of prostitution was criminalized because mayor said that in their area, prostitution was going to be criminalized, starting on a given day. And since they were doing a field, they were conducting a field work there for other reasons, they can study whether it affected sexually transmitted diseases among female sex workers. And they find that it increases disease prevalence. Not here, the person who asked me about the definition of prostitution, I use the term sex workers because this is the term that they also use in their paper, and this is the data they collected. So, just a couple of information about the law, the Nordic model. So it prohibits to buy sexual services, but not to sell them. And what kind of risk are customers facing? So either a fine or up to 6 months of, in jail, depending on how severe is the crime. So
is a crime subject to prosecution?
Yeah, is it
to standard prosecution?
So, as far as I know, it depends on the incidents, it depends on how many people, how many prostitutes were involved, how many other customers were involved. Okay. So, from time to time, officers...
Fine. I'm just trying to understand the situation. The fine can be divided by police officer.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Or does the judge...
No, no, the fine is issued by the police officer.
Well, the jail sentencing is subject to a
but
judiciary.
As far as you know, even the fine then can be, yeah. As it happens with many other fines, even traffic fines can be.
Yeah, yeah, fine, fine.
It's fine about fines.
And are you going to show us the separate impact on each of them? Were the fines go up the sentencing goes up or
I don't have data about whether the, I only have data about the fines that were issued. Police.
Not on time in prison.
Yeah, not on time in prison. I don't know whether this data is available or not.
Is it not in the press, in the Swedish press either? That is, you don't have it, but you don't have it. But did the Ministry of Justice in Sweden not issue a summary statistics in the press?
So they have some data about it. The fact is that, as far as you know, they are reluctant to share it because they try to have their own reports about the effect of this law, but they're not causal reports. They're more qualitative oriented. They share some data, and I did my best. But actually, when I was at the European University Institute, a good friend of mine is Swedish, and I tried to contact these people, but it was quite difficult. It was even difficult to get data on officers, which I'm going to use. I have the data of officers hired by region each year.
Legislative change on each of the two ends. Is it minor crimes? It's not even a crime. I guess a fine is an administrative sanction, right?
Yeah, a fine is an administrative sanction.
So did this change work on fine? You're going to tell us that it works on the administrative side.
Yeah.
But what about the media side, which is, I guess, the toughest
one? I guess at least this might be good for motivating this.
Question and knocking at the data.
So, what about sex tourism? I'm gonna talk about sex tourism because I understand that if prostitution was forgotten by economists, who made it sex tourism. So, I'm gonna give a brief introduction about it. So, sex tourism is a recent phenomenon in which customers of prostitution travel to other countries for buying sex. Okay. It was debated in the World Tourism Organization, and they even provided a definition, okay? So they refer to prostitution as trips organized with the primary purpose of effecting a commercial sexual relationship by the tourists with residents at the destination. I found different evidence in the literature that countries as Brazil and Thailand are the two most popular destinations for Swedish sex tourism. And they come from these papers conducted more qualitative research, but still. So, moreover, sex tourism became a more important phenomenon in Sweden since even the parliament discussed to ban the purchase of sex abroad, but they don't know exactly how to enforce this law. Okay, so they are aware that after the sex offlagen law was introduced, now this is what they had. Now I'm going to talk a bit about the data set and introduce the descriptive statistics. So I construct a regional monthly panel database for Sweden, where we have 21 regions, and they go from January 1997 to December 2014. And data on crimes comes from this institution I just mentioned before, the Swedish National Council for Crime Prevention. So they are in charge of collecting data on crime, which in Swedish is really a big name and is a very big bro. Okay. From the Swedish Transport Agency, I retrieve data for sex tourism, and then from the police department, I have data on the numbers of police officers hired per region each year. These are the main sources of data, and now I'm going to show some summary statistics. So what I have data.
What's the data you have
here? Region, month. Yeah. 21 regions, 12 months.
You can disaggregate more.
I cannot.
Although I guess, is there any, again, anecdotal evidence that within a region, provincial or region capitals are the places where most of the variation in your variables comes from, or is it very dispersed from here? Just to get a sense. Of...
As far as I know, through how Sweden is populated, everything happens in the cities. So this shouldn't change as much. You have a bunch of zeros, basically. So the nice thing about this data set is that, a feature that I think can give us a higher sense of how rape changes is that it has data on the type of rape. Okay, so I have total rape, but then I have whether rape was completed, was attempted, and so these are two mutually exclusive categories. And there are two other mutually exclusive categories, whether it took place outdoor or indoor. And I will use this for the mechanism analysis. Then I use data on fines for sex to chase. Okay, so these mean tell us that on average in each region, one fine for entry is issued with a really high standard.
Yeah, in a month. Only 1.3
per month. Exactly.
Do you notice the enforcement of the law is very low in Sweden?
It
looks very low.
But the fact is that it's very dispersed. You know, we have a really high standard deviation. So actually, there are places where nothing happens, and there are places where everything happens. And this also motivates the fuzzy difference in this, because with places where nothing happens, but something happens, but those are natural candidates for being in the control group.
And it looks that there are problems to enforce the law. In Sweden. So the police, the judicial system maybe have problems to really make the enforce the.
So the main issue is connected to how different offices in different regions enforce the law different. The issue is that, as far as I know, there is no clear variable to measure this. Berlin et al. Tried to carry out this exercise with the share of female police officers among the total, and the share of female politicians, but there is not, this is a guess, but there is no clear measure that the government said, you know. I tried to gather data on the budget they have, on the number of vehicles they were devoting only for this, because many times these fines are issued in raids. The police knows that there is a kind of event, go there, and maybe 1 month they issue 200 fines. And then there is this data, which is fine events, which is nothing else than the binary the binary variable for fines for sex purchases. And this is what I will use in the participation and in study analysis. Then I also have data on pimps, which I will use it to proxy the supply prostitution, because we have no data about prostitutes, because it's not a grant to sell sex.
Excuse me. Yeah, I have an additional question on the observation of rape, because it might be the case that some of the cases, particularly attempted cases, were not reported because the victim was feared to report to the police or something like that, and that might change a lot the whole picture of the numbers and the conclusion that you are trying to get.
Sure. I totally agree with you. I have a further paper on my webpage, which is called On the Association Between Rape and Prostitution, in which I explore the difference in data across countries. Sweden is the country where there are less issues connected to reporting rape. Actually, if you see the data, it looks like that all rapes that take place in Europe happen in Sweden. But it's not because this is true, it's because they... go to the police and report it. In any
by definition, it's very difficult to observe. I mean, you can make a hypothesis if you want, but by definition, it's very difficult to observe that.
But
I mean,
attempted rape, sorry. I think maybe this is the issue. Completed rape, as far as I know, is connected to the fact that there was penetration. Okay?
Yeah, I mean, the victim was not. Yeah, my point is the victim does not want to report to the police because.
But the victim
maybe
want to report to the police even if rape was completed. The issue is that unfortunately there are many victims that might fear to face shameful situations if they report the crime.
Exactly.
But this is not But this is not connected to whether the crime took place indoor, outdoor, whether it was completed, whether it was only attempted.
These are reported.
Sorry?
These are all reported.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay.
In the other, so for instance, but we, I would like to update about crimes that are not reported, but I'm not God, so I cannot know. The issue I can tell you is if we think that attempted rape, for instance, what I think is that attempted, the likely to report a crime might change over here. So this is why I include year fixed effect. Might change over here with a trend for different region. This is why I include a region year trend. Might change.
Yeah, but, across... sorry, but I guess that rape will be your dependent variable, right?
Yes.
And we are observing the dependent variable with a bias. We are observing sort of a lower bound of the dependent variable.
Yes, but this happens for every crime that you have to report. Even, I don't know, but even bullying situations. Or and I totally understand sure. The crime literature, but I cannot...
Well, I think there's a difference because if we talk about bullying, you might think that people might lie, that might cheat. Here, I think it's pretty much different. Here, I think what I observe is a lower bound.
Okay, we can have a guess about whether it's a lower bound or it's not, and whether, I don't know, even the issue with reporting is random or is not random. The only thing I wanted to say is that this is an issue for all the crime literature in general, for many other crimes, gender, okay. Domestic okay. Violence, gender violence, how you want to call it, it's an issue. Even for GDP is an issue.
You have to answer what is the,
yeah, I can,
the potential consequence.
Yeah, but,
it's a lower and upper bound.
Open a discussion.
It depends on whether what is observed is correlated with your independent variable, which in this case is a ban, which is criminalizing, right?
It's criminalizing. Yeah.
And
so
I think in the interest of time, my short answer would be as long as criminalization is not is unlikely to be heavily related to underreporting. Then
actually criminalization of prostitution gives more power somehow. It was a law for decreasing gender inequality, to improve gender equality, so the issue of reporting should decrease once this. So from this point of view, I understand my estimates are a lower bound, but what I wanted to say, just after all, it's a discussion about how we think the nature of.
In this case, I think this is fine, right? Lower bound is what everybody likes. What you don't want is nothing.
Yeah, yeah.
Assuming that. But that's exactly the issue.
There are more cases.
We have a lower bound because criminalization may actually increase reporting.
Yes.
So you have a correlation between an observable variable and your. Independent variable, which is positive, which makes your estimate lower bound, and so you know what you're saying. It's not as much, it is not as fun as you would like, but somehow you're saying. In addition, was I a natural experiment? I guess. And okay, but yeah, there's a lower bound point.
I think your results are true, are correct for. The assumption that the reporting or not reporting does not depend on the policy, on the policy. So it's like kind of constant.
The issue is that even if it's not, I have some control variables, let's say, to try to address it. So, identification assumption for the fuzzy difference in difference and from the event study. Treatment is given by fine events. So conditional on the considered controls in regions where a fine event takes place would have followed the same trend with untreated regions if the fine didn't occur. in the fuzzy settings, all regions are treated by vendor of a sample period. So why this is a fuzzy difference and it's not a sharp difference? Because all regions are treated by vendor of a sample period, and because there is the changes in treatments is not sharp. Okay. Some regions experience a much larger increment in fine events than others. It's not in the regular, it's 1, 0, and then the increments are similar in other treated groups. So what I do here to discuss the distribution assumption, I provide a balance check. This was suggested by a referee and was carried out in another paper in the grand literature by Azer and Doi. About juvenile incarceration. So these are the fines. I take the total fines and I divide it in per size. So the bottom per size, the middle per size, and the top per size. Okay. Here I provide the p-value of the difference between the bottom and the middle per size. And here I provide the p-value of the difference between the top and the middle per size. So for fines, we see the difference are statistically significant. Then I provide this difference for first, demographic characteristics, okay, which we might think might be connected to how rape occur, and I disaggregate them by male and female. So here, for example, for instance, at employment, okay, I see that there are the bottom tercile of the total fine events, which comparison to the middle tercile, there are no statistical difference, so they're quite similar. And they carry out this analysis for every variable: employment, population, immigration, married people, then single people, divided by male and female, and they find that no one is statistically different at statistical levels. Here we have a p-value of 16%, which is low. And then I carried out the same analysis, but for the control variable that I'm going to use, which is the number of policemen, and the same issue takes place. What is the identification assumption behind the ID? I discussed this briefly earlier. Here I have this nice graph. So using the return to school in a classic example, in which the effect of education on wage, in the past, they used access to college measured by distance, and so this didn't have to this need to be exogenous, and this instrument also didn't have to affect directly the outcome variable, so this is called the exclusion restriction. In this paper, I do something similar. So, fines for sex purchase is the treatment variable, rape is the outcome variable, and access to sex tourism measured by variation in offering of flights is the instrument. As long as we believe that this variation only affects rape through prostitution, so fines for sex purchase, and and is exogenous to rape, is not, they didn't choose these flights because of any rape issues. This identification assumption is plausible. Empirical strategy for the fuzzy difference in this. So here I take the log of 1 plus rate. Here I have a number of total fine events, okay, which are in the treatment variable related. And here I have region fixed effect, month fixed effect, year fixed effect, the number of offices, and then the error. This is important, but to keep in mind that given the structure of the study, the considered treatment variable can or increase or stay stable. It cannot decrease. Okay, the fuzzy difference in this, there will be no problem for a treatment to decrease. Okay, not in a sharp setting, but in the fuzzy one. But here, this one. But even empirical strategy of the even study. Here, the main issue is that in the even study, we try to estimate the timing of effect. But fines might be consecutive, might take place in similar months. So I I take a time window that takes place. I choose a time window that makes use of two windows before issuing of the fine and two windows post the issue of the fine. In the case that there is a consecutive fine, I make use of the largest time window I have. So if in February and March there were two fine events, then I add plus 2 months. So I go April and May And then I had 2 months in the past from February, so it would be January and December, to analyze this event. Why I do that? Because otherwise I cannot tell whether the effect was because of the first fine or of the second fine. Again, I have region fixed effect, month fixed effect, year fixed effect, and an officer control. I include in both specification also region year trends in the robustness checks. So, fine events is a binary variable, and as I just explained, the choice of considering J2 is considered to this issue. I cannot include the last thing, I cannot include the last lag and the lead of the event study to take one once for all, because these events are not everlasting event. There is a fine, and then there may be another one in 12 months. So this is maybe the main difference with other event studies.
If I do mix, help me understanding whether I'm really not correctly. The previous specification is your main result. Previous specification, but that's the main result. Yeah.
So I have three main specifications that get similar, and so I use the three of them.
And this is for the, what is this?
This is the event study. So
for your mechanisms.
No, no. Also for estimating the effect. I estimate. Now I will. I will get to a slide in which I have the three estimates, and I show how the three estimates.
Okay, so instrument finds.
Instrument finds. Okay, here I have fine events, and I use fine events in two ways. Here to estimate the timing of effect, and here to estimate the size of effect. Okay, the fudge diff and diff, and the instrument. On top of that, I have a instrumental variable. What is the issue that nowadays, every time we have a paper with ID, many people don't like the ID because they don't buy the school jurisdiction. So what I tried to do was to carry out further analysis and check the size of the effect. So with a different distribution assumption. If I find a similar effect, then it, I guess it's more reliable. Here, this is the second stage specification. And here I just remind the distribution assumption, OK? So here I show the results for the fudge difference in this. Okay, this is an estimate of 0.4. Later I talk about the robustness of effect and about all this table. Here I show the results of even studies. Similarly, later I will talk about the robustness of the effect. So is we find similar results between the even study. So here is 0.03, before it was 0.04. So there statistically, we take the standard error there statistically similar. Here I show the result of the first stage. Okay, so here I use two instruments. This is the offering intercontinental flight. This one, there are higher intercontinental flights. And this is where there are lower continental flights. I use two instruments in different ways. First, I use them separately, and then I even add them. And then I have another table in which I use them, taking only one and taking. Oh, here it is not. This is the table. So here I use only one. Here I use only the second one. The results are the same. I will also show this. I also have a table for this in the second stage. The F statistic is always far beyond 10.
Yeah.
Intercontinental. This is the higher offering of intercontinental flights. But I want to consider when there is a lower offering of continental flights, because usually also like the prices depends on the offerings.
And so how do you read
that? So that
how is that measured?
So when number of flights. So this would be
increase by one unit in intercontinental flights, reduces.
It reduces by
reduces fines.
Reduces fines. Yeah. This is when on the other hand, when there are many intercontinental flights when there are few continental flights, continental inside Europe. Okay? The other percent of the result of the second stage is expected to the result of the OLS. So I don't know if there's time to present the OLS, but for now I present the results of ID. If then I have time, I have also a slide in which I compare, because the size of the two is quite different. And so the results of ID are that issuing a fine increases tax purchase by 0.02. So we have 0.02, 0.03, 0.04. And this is here what I present. Here I present the even study, okay? The green line is the world bits. This is the fuzzy difference estimate. This is the VID coefficient, and this is the OLS coefficient. Okay, so we see that the ID coefficient, this is 10.0. These are the bounds of the confidence interval for the event study. We see that the VID coefficient and the ID coefficient are statistically equal to the event study coefficient at 10.0. Okay, otherwise is much lower. For reasons on the endogeneity, reverse causality, I try to address this in the paper as best as I can. Here, for the sake of time, I'm not speaking about this. So, taking the total amount of fines that were issued during this period, I'm able to compute how the band so. I find that this increment is between 44% and 62% from 1999 to 2014, which was the sample period I considered. The effect looked like to be temporary. So we see, yeah, there is no effect, then there is an effect, and then in the following month there is no effect either. This I also carry out an IV even study and find similar results. So I compared the results with Cunningham and Shada study decriminalization of prostitution. I found that they decreased by 50%. With Bishop that find it, Bishop et al. That find it, the effect of least licensing prostitution, so red light districts. And they found that those decrease the rate by 30-50%. And so I discussed in the scholarship, because this is something that was also found in Cameron, Mood and Shah, effect of criminalizing prostitution looks like to be in absolute value larger, so not to be symmetrical, to effect of decriminalizing prostitution. This might be the case because of different costs when you criminalize prostitution, frictions that you might find. And this is what I find. So here, then I have target. Sorry.
Yes, I'm a bit lost. About the interpretation of the first stage.
Yeah.
An increase in this intuitively, there's a negative relationship between the intercontinental flights and fines. And instead a positive?
No. So in the, so this is, these are periods in which there is a higher offering of intercontinental flights.
So the offer.
And this is the one. And then the two is the opposite for continental flights. So
So intercontinental flights offers decrease fines, and continental flight offers increases fines.
Yes.
So where if I am to look for the people who are fined, I have to look for continental tourism. Continental tourists. So the continental tourists are those who get the fines.
So intercontinental, those who go to Brazil and Thailand. So those who organize those trips are more likely.
Right. Okay. So it's intercontinental flights whose destination is different than Sweden. That was my
yes.
If they get out
from Europe. So here I further assumption.
Six tourists go out. Let's see.
Yes.
There are places, there are other countries competing for Swedish, for Sweden, for, competing with Sweden on sex tourism.
Yeah, there are a destination that people who buy prostitution in Sweden prefer. Now they face the fine, and so they try to go elsewhere. Yeah. But this depends on flight companies because they cannot. Next, I'll discuss the mitigation of sanction possibility, besides of the estimates comparison between OLS and ID. Is the instrument measuring sex tourism? I have a possible question for this, and then I can examine my results. So how much I have? 10 minutes, 15? I'm a lot wishful thinking if I think I can address all this. 10 minutes. Okay. Shall I try to address all this, or do you prefer to focus on? Okay. So this one I already explained about imbalance effort. Okay, so let's read this one. This is the assumption for the instrumental variable, and here I try to provide evidence about the exclusion restriction. Okay, so the exclusion restriction tells us that flights only affect rape through prostitution, so through fines. So a natural test, because exclusion restriction is untestable, would be to check in the reduced form, so rape as y and rape on the left hand side of the equation and the instrument on the right hand side of the equation, before the ban was introduced and after the ban was introduced. Okay, if the exclusion restriction makes sense, we would expect to find negative statistical coefficients, statistically negative coefficients only for the period after the ban. Okay, and this is what we find. Here I have the reduced form, including different controls. So here without yet effect and regional yet trends, and then here include yet effect and here include regional trends, and here I do the same, the period after the ban. People might say in any case that this difference, because here that we have some coefficients which are negative but not statistically significant, some which are even positive, are only due to the fact of few observations. So what I do now is that I focus on a period after the ban. I define a variable cumulative fines by region. I do something similar to the balance test which I just showed for the fuzzy definition and variance study. So this variable cumulates the number of fines for each region as time passes. And I separate the sample in data above and below the median. Why I do this? So I have a balanced sample size. Okay, it's not exactly the same. Here I have 1,800, but it's quite similar. So below the median, basically, and above the median. So for data below the median, I get positive estimates besides this one, okay, which is negative but not statistically negative. For data above the median, I get all estimates to be negative, and in this regression, this one is negative and this one is statistically negative. I couldn't come to any other, let's say, rational justification to try to test the validity of exclusion restriction any other way. If any of you can, this would be something I like to put in the paper. Then the other thing is the size. So the OLS and the estimates are quite different. The issue is that in the literature, and this is another paper I have, it's a short paper, but in the literature, there is no proper methodology to compare VEGI and the OLS estimates. To the best of my knowledge, we only compare them in percentage. We say this one is 10% of the ID, but it doesn't rely on any statistics. So Oster suggested that a methodology to test for omitted variable bias in a OLS setting, as we had controls for regression that relies on the coefficient and to relies on the coefficient and on the square. I, in another paper, I try to adapt this methodology in an ID setting, okay? And so the assumption behind the methodology is that if selection on observables is proportional to selection of unobservables, so you would believe that the observables that we are including in our regression might be to some extent proportional to our observables, then we can compute an interval that spans all the true variable, all the true values of the treatment effect given the variable bias. So this methodology can easily be adapted in cases of IV and OLS estimates. Also here, we can try to pin down this coefficient of proportionality, but the intuition behind this is that we can say how large selection on unobservables need to be to explain the ID estimates. If selection on unobservables needs to be really high, then it's unlikely that. And so here, this is these are all the upper bounds of the estimates. This is selection of proportionality. So it ranges from 0 to minus 10. And this is all the upper bound of identified set. Okay. This OLS is this point here. As long as we have selection observable slightly above 1, in this case is 1.2, negative 1.2, we get the ID estimate. So this selection observable doesn't need to be as large as if we only compare the OLS and the ID. It needs to be 1.2 with respect to 1. So it is not as like a substantial increase. So robust and not specific. So
does this pay for a question mark?
Sorry?
Does this pay for a question mark in your title? Because you are saying that the someone's potential effect on the result is not.
Here I'm saying that we don't need to have a large selection on unobservables to motivate the size of the ID estimates. If we compare the ID estimates, I have them here. If we compare them by eyeball, only by comparing, we see, this one is 12 times this one. It's a lot. But how much selection on unobservables do we need to have this estimate? Because only by comparing, we cannot, from my understanding, it's like we are not comparing, we don't know how much selection on unobservables we need to have. Or we cannot,
you
we are not comparing
to
any statistic.
You are relying too much on common friends. So all those unobservables will be capturing all those differences.
Yeah, but the only thing that here in this methodology, I don't use the ID. The only thing that we use in this methodology is in an OLS setting, how much selection on unobservables do we need to have an estimate like the ID one? That doesn't need to be quite large, or does it not need to be quite large? So, and this relies on the coefficient and on the squared. So, I think this comparison is a bit more informative than the one without only comparing the ID and the OLS. Two coefficients can be really close to each other if we compare them percentage, but then maybe we need a lot of selection on observables to motivate this distance. This is not the case for this. For this paper. But this is a methodology I developed in another paper, in another paper, and if you find it interesting, I'm happy to talk about it at lunch. Robust specification. Here I show, like in the first stage, in the second stage, when I use Z1 and Z2, when I use only Z1, when I use only Z2, and when I sum the two, and estimates are stable across these four specifications. Robustness of the fuzzy diff in diff, one includes region year trends, includes year month fixed effect. Here, then I change the IH, so from the log specification, I use the inverse hyperbolic sine transformation. And then I carry out the same, the main specification, the region year trends, year month fixed effect. this is something I carry out also for the second stage in the paper. It's a huge table, but we don't have it here. And then I report the same thing for the event study, okay, with the exact same format, including engineer trends, year month, fixed effect, and then changing the functional form of a demanded variable, and results are stable. Then I do a placebo regression. I use national flights, European flights, and total flights, okay? But increases in this flight. Why I do this? I use the same measure to see, are really intercontinental, high periods of intercontinental flights and low periods of continental flights measuring sex touring? Then I carry out the same analysis, but during this flight we shouldn't be connected. And I find that there are no results, not even in the first stage, not even very useful, suggesting that these estimates are not due to flights per se. And then I check, I don't think I have time for this. Can I go directly to the mechanism so that this is about heterogeneous effect. So what I do here basically is that the ID can differ from real S because there are heterogeneous effects across the population because it's a local average treatment effect. And so what I do here is I try to estimate this, I try to provide evidence about whether these estimates are different because of this issue. But if you don't mind, I'll go directly to the mechanism so that I can wrap up in on time. Constitutionality, fine. Okay, potential mechanism. So basically, I check whether this effect is driven by supply mechanism or by demand mechanism. How do I measure this supply mechanism? I use PIMPs as the output variable. Well, in demand mechanism, I can distinguish, as I said at the beginning of the talk, between completed versus attempted rape and between indoor versus outdoor rapes. So the effect on PIMPs from using both instruments is this one, using only instrument one is this one, using only instrument two is this one, and using Z1 plus Z2 is this one, and this is using the world this and this. The effect on PIMPs using the supply mechanism, using something, the even study. So, first of all, we find that introducing these fines always increase the number of PIMPs, suggesting that the supply is not decreasing.
How do you measure PIMPs? So you have
it's a crime.
Okay.
So I have data on.
Okay.
But what is even more interesting in this case, we have fine evidence of. So the effect also takes place in the second month, but also. There are pretrends in the sense that once the laws introduced, once they know that these fines are issued, they're not even scared, okay? Because PIMPs was a crime before the introduction of the ban, and it's a crime after the introduction of the ban. So they don't. So this suggests that this supply, in any, if anything happened, increased, didn't decrease, but this cannot explain that we find that rape rose, okay? So this might be explained by a change in demand. And here, what I find is that with the introduction of the ban, completed rape increases, while attempted rape decreases in all specifications, but the fuzzy difference is different. A similar result can be found in the event study, okay? This is completed rape, while this attempted rape. In this case, we satisfy no effect. But the stable effect across specification is that completed rape increases. This goes in line with another strand of the literature, which I said at the beginning that was suggested by Marcello, this study in another theoretical paper, which I didn't mention, that I mentioned in my paper, that suggests that introducing these bands changes the profile of customers and rapists. Okay, these people are more risky. And this is, so just to wrap up, This is consistent also with outdoor and indoor rates. I have also slides about to them at the end of the presentation. I didn't know if they had more time or not, but this indication I can present that. So this paper finds that criminalizing sex purchase boosts rate temporarily, and that this ban gave rise to an increase between, sorry, this is a typo, this is 44, between 44 and 60%. And the results are stable across different specification and across different econometrics techniques. The effect of criminalizing seems to be larger than the effect of decriminalizing, and looks like to be demand-driven. At least it doesn't look like to be supply-driven, because if anything happened, the supply increased. The fact that it looks like to be demand-driven is because of a change in the composition of rate. Peaks increase, completed rate boosts, while attempted rate decreases. Then in the paper also look for an effect on other sorts of crime connected to sex crimes, I don't know, sexual coercion, so like sexual harassment, which is connected to rape, but it's not exactly rape, or not connected, like even bike theft, but more connected to seasonality, other seasonality further, and the number of offices, but there are no effects on other sorts of crime.
Is baseline crime balance?
Sorry?
Is baseline crime balance?
Baseline crime?
Yes. You have a balance check in which you have the, whether an employment, whether the population.
I didn't settle. I can do that. So this table, I just did it after the last referee report site. So the table I showed you, basically I did it 10 days ago.
Did you also analyze the effect of fines on other kind of sexual crimes?
Sorry.
Did you also try to analyze the effect of the increasing fines in other forms of sexual violence, not only rape?
I mean,
domestic violence.
I have sexual coercion, domestic violence, and human trafficking for sexual purposes. And this is addressed in the paper. The issue with some is human trafficking and domestic violence is that the sample period is a bit smaller than I want to start.
Did you find significant?
I don't remember. I should check. I address it. I'm really bad in memorizing stuff.